Praise the Lord. Amen. He was nailed to the cross, wasn't he? Tells us in Isaiah and Romans, all day long he held out his hands to a rebellious people. All day long he held out his hands to a rebellious people. Wow. He's got open arms for broken hearts. Open arms for broken hearts. There's nobody more loving and nobody more real. There's no greater man that's ever lived. There's no greater example. Open arms for broken hearts like yours, my son. Come home. Come home. I want to look this morning at, I think it's a wonderful account of a woman bent over double. It's Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13, verse 10. Lord, we thank you for your presence this morning. There's a reverence here for you, Lord. Only you know the future, Lord. We can only pray, Lord, for the leaders. Some we vote in and others are put there. But we do pray, my God, Lord, for Donald Trump. We pray, my God, that you would give that man wisdom. He's going to need so much wisdom, Lord. Give him wisdom. We pray for our country, for Theresa May. We pray for Europe. Lord, we pray, my God, Lord, let your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come, Lord, even this morning. Sow your kingdom word into your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Luke chapter 13, verse 10. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. If you were to apply that to 2016... Jesus has come to a certain church and he's teaching in that certain church. And behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity 18 years. The only thing that we know about this woman is that she was in the right place at the right time. That's all we know. The only thing we can say about this woman that she did right is that she was in church when Jesus turned up. She was a believer. The text tells us that. She was a daughter of Abraham. We can certainly insinuate from this that this woman had been coming to the synagogue for years. And for years nothing had happened. But this particular day, Jesus himself turns up in the synagogue. Jesus turns up. And that's how it is in the Christian walk, folks. And I remember as a young Christian, I didn't want to miss a meeting. I really didn't. And I worked crazy hours. Saturday, all the way through till Sunday, 24 hours. I had a pager that would go off and the calls would stack up. You're in Shrewsbury and then you've got another job in Market Drayton. There's one in Hanley. There's a guy screaming for you in Whitchurch. There's somebody in Congleton going mad. And every time you did one job, another four would come in and it would go on and on and on and on. I couldn't wait for church the next day. I really couldn't, folks. And you know, most of the time, It was just a nice church service. But occasionally, God broke through and God spoke something into my life. I got an impact. And this, here's a woman who's going to the synagogue week in, week out. But on this particular morning, Jesus himself turns up. Now, there are people that go to church to observe what's wrong with church. That's what they go for. There are those that go to church to observe what's right with church. And they look around and they can say, well, that's right about that one. And we're all like that to a degree. But I don't like that. But then Jesus is different than us. Jesus goes to the synagogue to find out what is the greatest need. He doesn't go to see what's wrong. He doesn't go to see what's right. He goes to see what is the need in that place this morning. And that's how we should be coming to church. We should always come to church with something to give, folks. We should come through those doors with something to give. Give to one another and give to the Lord. The two are synonymous. And Jesus walked into that place that morning, not to look at what was wrong, not to look at what was right, but to look at the need. What was the need? It was a woman who'd faithfully been going for years. Nothing had ever happened to her, and she was bent over double. Have you ever seen anybody like that? Me and my friend Andy Machin, he was my best friend. He used to joke when we used to go down Congleton to the pubs. He used to say, look, there's that guy again. He still hasn't found that fiver. And every time you'd see him, he'd be bent over double like this. Every time my friend would say, look, he's still not found that fiver. I used to think, you know, even back then before, as I say, I thought that's not very tasteful. That guy is in extreme discomfort. There are many people that are bent over double physically. But I believe that Jesus is pointing to something more than physical here. I believe there are people that are bent over double spiritually. So, this is the situation. He was teaching in one of the synagogues. Note, it was on the Sabbath. Behold, there was a woman who had a spirit. It's a spirit of infirmity. For 18 years was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. She could in no way raise herself up. It had to be a work outside of herself. But when Jesus saw her, he's looking at the need. He said to her, woman, you are loosed from your infirmity. That's all he said. He's teaching away. He sees her. He sees the need. Stops the message. Looks at her. Can you even begin to imagine his eyes as he looks at her with such passion? We saw on Wednesday that Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Jesus had emotions, folks. He wasn't this emotionless leader. He had emotion. I wonder what his eyes looked like as he looked upon this poor woman who'd been this way for 18 years. And he says, woman, you are loosed. You're free. And the Bible says immediately, she was straightened out. Immediately, something happened immediately in that synagogue. There was an awesome miracle. Something that she could never do that Jesus did. He laid his hands on her and immediately she was made straight and she glorified God. So far, so good. But this is what happens. We don't expect this. And this is why the Christian walk is narrow and it's difficult. And there are few that find it. Because so very often in your Christian walk, in doing good, you get attacked. You just don't expect it. When you sign up to become a Christian, when you believe on the Lord, you sign up to walk with him, you never perceive that sometimes in doing the very best of things, you're going to be attacked. And I know people in this church, good people, good people, that over the years have done this very thing. They've done good. And in doing good, they've been attacked. Sometimes even satanically. The devil hates good, folks. Hates it. He hates it when we do good. At the start of this year, I don't even remember, I said, I believe I have a verse for this year for you. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. It's great when we can do good. It makes us feel good when we do good. But the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation. He was livid. Livid. So there's a woman who's been like this week in and week out. And when Jesus comes on the scene, obviously miraculously touches her life, the leader is livid. Why? Because religion binds. Religion doesn't set a person free. Religion binds a person. Religion paralyzes a person. And there were so many rules and regulations concerning the Sabbath that they just couldn't really do anything. They'd lost the meaning of what true religion was. It had got lost in the red tape. This man was out of control that morning because Jesus, when Jesus walks in a meeting, folks, every knee must bow. And he was so angry because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath. How ridiculous. How religious we get sometimes, folks. How stupidly religious we become. And he said to the crowd, notice he didn't look Jesus in the eye. I wasn't going to take Jesus on. There are 6 days of which men ought to work. Therefore, come and be healed on one of those, and not on the Sabbath. And the Lord answered him and said, so I want you to get this. This is our Lord. This is the God of the Bible. God in flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. You're looking right now at the character of God. He looks at the woman who's been in torment with eyes of compassion and lays his hands on her, touches her life, says, be lifted up, be raised up. The very same Jesus turns his eyes to this synagogue ruler and declares to him that he is a hypocrite. Can you imagine Jesus looking you in the eye? It tells us in Matthew chapter 25, there is a place assigned for the hypocrites, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, a place of darkness. And Jesus gives him the verdict, a man that's been there for a long time. This is my verdict on what you are. You are a hypocrite. And you've completely lost your way. Hypocrite. It's like an Exocet missile locking onto the target. There's no way out. Christ has singled this man out. You are blocking the work of God. You are a hypocrite. Amazing, isn't it? The same Jesus. Oh, many of you will have gone up Snowdon via the train. And you go up Snowdon via the train, this gradual slope, you know how they all are, they pay the whatever it is, it's not cheap, is it? And they tootle up, they tootle up to Snowdon, they get to the top, they get off the train, they walk into the cafe, they have a nice cup of coffee, and then they go back on the train, and you would never, ever dream that that mountain can be so unforgiving. Never. But if you go to the top of Snowdon via Crib Gock on the other side, and some of you have seen Crib Gock, Crib Gock is terrifying. It is the worst ridge in the UK. There's nothing like it. Foolishly, we once led some younger Christians up there some years ago in the snow. I mean, the snow was up there. And we didn't even get to the summit of Cribgoc. To get across the edge, we saw seasoned professional climbers turning round and coming back. At that point, I realised we were way out of our depth here. We were trying to handle something that was untamable. One of our friends slipped down a gully, cut himself up. There's all blood in the pure white snow. It was messy, but we got down. It's the same mountain. One side of that mountain, one false move and you're dead. The other side, you can tittle up there, eating your ham sandwiches on the way up, have a little cup of tea at the top, go back down, nothing. Wonderful. Snowdon, I've been there, done that, got the t-shirt, no problem. Do it via Cribgoc and you will be terrified. In fact, I took Caesar over Cribgoc, and Caesar is very much, he has no problem with heights whatsoever. And he got halfway across that edge and wanted to sit down. He didn't want to go any further because it was so, so frightening. This is our God, folks. We can't tame him. He's untamable. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah. Yes, he's the Lamb of God, but he's also the lion. And he was a sweet lamb to the woman that needed that encouraging. A woman that had been forgotten. Jesus never forgets anybody. He hasn't forgotten you. But the same lamb becomes a lion. And he looked him in the eye and he declared, "You are a hypocrite." And if that doesn't frighten you, folks, I don't want to die and come face to face with Jesus and he say, "You're a hypocrite. And you've been assigned a place with the hypocrites." I don't want that. Hypocrite. Does not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his donkey from the stall and lead it to water? What's Jesus saying here? You see, in that day, your pets, they were part of your family. They were part of your family. Don't you look after your family on the Sabbath? You would never dream of not looking after your family on the Sabbath, whether that be your son or your daughter, or whether that be one of your pets. And yet this woman, who's not part of your initial family, you don't really care about her, has been bound. And Jesus says, "Think about it, man. Think about it, because you never have done. You've been here for years, you've seen her come in for years, and never once have you thought about her condition. Think about it. She's been bound by Satan for 18 years. That's Cribgoc. And there's no way out. So ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, think of it, for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath." That's our God. And when he said these things, all his adversaries were put to shame. And all the multitude rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done. What a man. What a man. I want to spend the next 15, 20 minutes just unpacking what it is to be spiritually bound, bent over. What does it mean? Are we or are we not? Are we free or are we loosed? It's important, isn't it? To know what we are. But I want to do this not through a "God spoke to me." I want to do it through the Word of God. I want to show you through the Word of God the condition of the people of God. If you want to turn, you can follow with me if you like, but Matthew chapter 23. In Matthew 23, Jesus knows he's going to the cross, and he speaks to them all. He just singles out the synagogue ruler in Luke chapter 13. In Matthew 23, he singles out every one of them and calls them all hypocrites because he knows where he's going. He knows he's going to the cross. And before he goes to the cross, he makes sure that they know his verdict on them. So it says in Matthew 23, verse 1, then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do, but do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do. And the very first thing that Jesus says that they do is this, for they bind heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them one finger. That's what Jesus said was going on at the time. The leaders were spiritually causing all of God's people to be bent over with these burdens of the law. They took the law to such an extent that you couldn't possibly keep it. Viv and Ray will probably tell you, even today with the Sabbath, the Jews have certain ways around things. Because you can't actually switch a light on the Sabbath, so they have a kosher lamp. A kosher lamp is a lamp that's always on, but it has a little slider that goes across so that you can see the light. So you don't have to actually switch it on. You're not switching it on. It's always on, but you slide it across. And that's the way it is, you see. That's the way it is when you are not loosed in Jesus Christ. And Jesus said to them, this is what you do. Now, all religions bind. If you spend some time talking to a Muslim, and there are many Muslims that want to talk, by the way, they really do want to talk. They love dialogue. But they'll tell you, they don't know if they're saved. It's a point system. They don't know at the end of this life whether they're going to be saved or not. There's no reassurance whatsoever. It's the same with Buddhism. It's the same with Hinduism. There is no assurance. None. Something that you and I take for granted. The poor Jehovah's Witnesses that go around the doors from door to door to door, they have no assurance whatsoever. I talked to an elder. He's one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. But I ask him, he says, oh, there's no assurance. You can't know. Nobody can know. Same with the Mormons, and I'm afraid to say, it's the same with the Roman Catholics. There is no assurance of salvation. How many times do you need to go to Mass per week to know that you're saved? Infinite, indefinite. That's what religion does. Religion puts burdens on you. You're so bound, you just can't see anything but your feet. Jesus said that's what they do. If you want to turn to Romans chapter 11, I'm going to expound on this a little bit. Look, Romans 11. The Apostle Paul is talking about the Jews that refuse to embrace Jesus as Messiah here. Romans 11. In verse 7 it says, what then? Israel has not obtained what it seeks, but the elect have obtained it, and the rest were blinded, just as it is written, God has given them a spirit of stupor, eyes that should not see, ears that do not hear to this very day. So David says about them, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a recompense to them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see, so that their backs be bent low forever. When Jesus pointed to the woman of Abraham, the daughter of Abraham, and he lifted her up, he loosed her, he was doing something that was way beyond the physical bending. According to the word of God, every Jew that refused to embrace Jesus Christ as Savior was bent over double, burdened by the law. Let their backs be bent over continually forever. Now, praise the Lord this morning. I'm not speaking to novices. And you know that we have been set free from the law, okay? Now, this is important. I have noticed in cities, that there is a revival, if you like, a resurgence of churches beginning to go back to the law in one way or the other. Certainly in Sabbatarians, they're getting bigger and bigger and bigger. They're going back to the law. I want to read you a few scriptures. And then I want to hopefully look at where we are. Where are we at in all this? Where's our back? Are we straight? Are we bent? Where are we? Romans chapter 10, you know this, but I'll read it to you. Verse 4, I love Romans 10. It's amazing. My lad asked me on the milk round the other day, what do you need to do to be saved? Do you need to be baptized to be saved? What is it you need to be saved? And I quoted Romans 10 to him. That's what you need to do to be saved, son. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. Christ is the end of the law to righteousness for everyone that believes. And he builds on that and he goes on to say, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. That's the difference. That's the faith, folks. That's what sets us apart from any other world religion. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everybody that believes. Woof, I'm straightened up. I'm not under any burden anymore. I don't need to prove anything to anybody anymore. Christ has done it for me. Christ is the end of the law. Galatians chapter 3, verse 10. Wonderful, wonderful chapter. For as many as are of the works, in other words, those that are trying to keep the law, the works of the law are under a curse. If you're trying to keep the law, you're under the curse of the law. As it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. If you decide in your heart you want to keep certain parts of the Mosaic law, you have to keep it all. You can't just pick and choose. Either Christ is the end of the law for you, or you have to keep all 613 precepts, including the garments that you wear, the threads that you wear. It went on. And Paul is saying here, let me tell you, you can't pick and choose. You can't be circumcised and then be free. You need to know what you are. Galatians chapter 5, verse 3. And I testify again to everyone who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. Now, I'm not talking about cultural Jews that do this because it's part of their culture here. I'm talking about people that try to keep certain laws because their salvation and their walk with God depend upon it. You can't do it. In fact, it tells you here, if you do it, listen, because this is always mutilated by church. This is how you fall from grace. It's not from messing up. People mess up. You fall from grace by going back to trying to keep the law yourself. That's the fall from grace. I'll just read this verse from Acts chapter 13. It's a lovely verse of scripture. I just absolutely love it. Some of these, you just don't see them. And then one day you see them and you think, goodness me, that's amazing. Acts 13:38. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man, that's Jesus, is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. Oh, that's beautiful. You can feel your spiritual back beginning to straighten up. He's done it. I'm righteous. I'm going to heaven because of him. Now, let me get to the point this morning. I say this for the camera alone. If you are trying to keep the law, you're falling from grace. You need to come back to the cross and repent from your fall from grace. Christ is the end of the law for all righteousness. However, we are not lawless. Did you get that? We are not lawless. And that's where the problem comes today. In Bible college, it's called antinomianism, where people believe that they are free from anything. And we're not. We're not. There are certain laws in Scotland that are not in England. And when you drive over that border, you come under different laws. And when you go from the Old Testament into the New, you're free from the law of Moses, but you come under the law of Christ. And here's my point this morning, friends. I believe there's lots of Christians that they've got that first bit. Praise God, they've got that first bit. It's gone down. It's sunken in. They know they're saved by grace. They know what Christ has done is absolutely real. He's paid their debt. But as yet, they've not begun to move into the law of Christ. Ian on Sunday night spoke about the river. We love that, don't we, Ezekiel's river? Because you can make it to be anything you want, can't you? And we went into the river and we were in toe deep. Ooh. And then the Spirit of the Lord said, come a bit deeper, come a bit. And we went up to our knees like this, and that was okay, but we ended up waist high, and all of a sudden we're out of control, and this wafty kind of new age river that really never challenges us or points out anything in our life, and all we go under, and we all need to go into the river. And that is by no way, I'm not having to go at Ian here, I'm trying to make a point, folks. Christ wants to take us from the law of Moses to the law of Christ. And there are a lot of people that dip their toe into the law of Christ and they don't like it and they start to pull back. And there are others that go in with the toe and think, my goodness me, this is something, isn't it? And they go into the knees and they think, oh man, I've never experienced joy like this, but I've never been challenged like this either. I'm pretty uncomfortable. I've got the joy, but I've got this massive challenge going on in my life. And then there comes a point where you're waist deep and suddenly you are out of control. There was a, I don't know, it wasn't a documentary. It was a film called Band of Brothers. Some of you may have seen it. There's a quote in Band of Brothers. I'll never forget it. There's a guy in a trench. He won't get out of the trench. He's terrified. I can understand that. Would you want to jump out of a trench and be cut to pieces by bullets? So he's in this trench and he's shivering and there's another guy next to him. And he says, you've got to get out of the trench. You've got to run at the enemy. He says, I can't do it. I can't do it. He says, listen, you will never become an effective soldier until you realize that you're already dead. You've already been shot. You're not going to get through this alive. You're dead. That was the quote of the film for me. That blew me away. You've come in. You're already dead, folks. Your life is not your own. I'm talking to me, Lord, you know. I'm talking to myself. But we play about with that river. There is a law. It's the law of Christ. Let me explain it to you before you think I am a heretic. John chapter 15, verse 11. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. What's the point in being a Christian if you're not experiencing the joy of being a Christian? And the only way of experiencing the joy of being a Christian is by keeping the royal law, by keeping the commands of Jesus, or the law of Christ, whatever you want to call it. And the law of Christ is this: love God. Love God with all your heart. Love him. But don't just love God. Love your neighbor as yourself. In fact, Jesus took it further. Jesus says, love them as I have loved you. That's the law of Christ. Now, as charismatics and Pentecostals and Christians in general, none of us have a real problem with loving God. We say it all the time. I love you, God. I love you. I thank you, God. I thank you. But we're much slower to love one another. We're much slower to thank one another. But you know, it's a cooperation. God doesn't do it on his own. He does it with you. Pastor said to me once, he pulled me up. He says, when somebody comes to you and says, that was a great sermon, don't say, oh, it was all of God. It was all God. It was none of me. He said, don't do that. Because it's a cooperation between you and God. You see, the royal command is, don't just love God, love the people of God. Love the people of God. And it's not easy sometimes, is it? It's not easy to love the people of God sometimes. But this is the law of Christ. We move from the law of Moses and we come into that river. And it ain't easy, is it? Some people put their big toe in it and they say, I love the joy, Lord, that I get when I do somebody good. I love that feeling. It's such a great feeling to help somebody, the joy that comes. But then I get attacked. Then I get attacked for doing good. And I can't handle that. So I'm taking my toe out and I'm going the other way. I'm going the other way. And there are Christians that are caught in no man's land. Take this as a prophecy this morning. There are Christians that are caught in no man's land. They're in the middle. They're not in the law of Moses and they're not in the law of Christ. They don't want to go any further because they know if they do, they'll get the joy, but they'll also get hurt. When you help people, you will be hurt. When you love people, you will be hurt. I remember saying to the Lord so naively, I said, Lord, now I'm married, I'll never be brokenhearted again. I remember telling him that. I'll never have to be brokenhearted again. Folks, when you love people, you're going to get your heart broken. Get in the river. You've been called to get in the river. You're a soldier of the living God. Get in that river. Sense the joy of doing good, and you will be hurt because your master was hurt for doing good. And a servant is not greater than his master. This is what he says. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Oh, I remember once going down to the bottom of our garden at Harrisy Head. I said, Lord, I don't like my mother-in-law. I really don't like her. I'm telling you, because your word says cast all your burdens. So I'm telling you, Lord, I don't like that woman. I'm down by the fence at the bottom of the garden, and the Lord said, love her and your joy will be full. Oh, why do you have to say that? This is my command, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than the one that lays his life down for his friends. You are my friends. If you do what I command you, there is another law. We are not lawless. This is not antinomianism. We are under another law. We are soldiers of the living God. That's why Paul begins Romans by saying, I'm a bond servant. I've been pierced, nailed to the door. I belong to Christ now. And all of us struggle putting sometimes even a big toe in. We don't mind loving God, but we struggle loving one another. Luke chapter 17 is an amazing scripture. It's wonderful, it's amazing. When Jesus did good, very often he got upset. He wept, didn't he, over Jerusalem? He wept. When you become all that God has called you to be, you will know the joy. You will know that joy. You will also know what it's like to be heartbroken. The two go hand in hand. Luke chapter 17, verse 11. Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village there, he met with 10 men who were lepers who stood afar. They all had one thing in common, their leprosy. One of them was a Samaritan. The Jews don't like the Samaritans. They can't stand one another, but they had this common ground. Their common ground was they were all lepers. Look around, take a look around this room now. There's people in this room that you would not knock about with in the natural. You wouldn't. But we have this common ground, and the common ground is that we were lepers. And lepers hang together. That's what unifies us. In this room, the people in this room know that they were sinners, and they know that the only one that has the cure for sin is Jesus Christ. We're lepers, folks. We've been brought together. It's like Noah's Ark. On Noah's Ark, you've got leopards in there. You've got little deer in there. Normally, they kill one another. Yesterday morning, we were just leaving the house, and at the church house, they've got this big cage of doves that flutter around everywhere. Lovely. This morning we saw a dove on the ground with a hawk eating it alive. Mandy got out, chased it away, and this hawk was hunting it down. That's church, folks. Church is full of lepers. It's full of sinners. They'd never normally knock around together, but we've been brought together through the one that has the cure for leprosy. Sin. His name is Jesus. Would I have ever met Joan if it wasn't for church? No. She'd probably... And they said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us, all of us. I love that. Not my God. My God, my God, my God. Us, all of us. Have mercy on all of us. Collectively, we need your mercy. So when he saw them, he said, go, show yourselves to the priest. That was, it all collectively had to take a step of faith. They were filthy, but go, show yourselves to the priest. And somewhere along that way, it's a bit like the water turning into wine. At what point did that water turn into the wine? Before the wine taster. It's a step of faith. And so it was that they went and they were cleansed. They were cleansed by obeying Jesus. When we obey the gospel, we get cleansed. And one of them, when he saw he was healed, returned with a loud voice glorifying God. He fell down on his face at his feet giving thanks, but he was a Samaritan. Jesus says, what's going on here? The only one that came back's a foreigner. Where's the others? Now I would imagine that all those others, when they show themselves to the priest, I would imagine all of them probably said, thank you, Lord. But only one went back to the man. Listen, folks, we are brilliant at thanking God. What about thanking one another? What about thanking one another? Somebody said to me the other day, they put some money towards the building. I said, I thank you. Why are you thanking me? It's God. I said, it's not just God. It's you too. It's God cooperating with a person. There has to be a cooperation between God and man. There are many people that get challenged to do something, but only a few do it. Jesus was upset here. He was upset. What's going on? This is what happens when we follow him. Friends, the hardest thing for a Christian is when you do good, you do the right thing, you know you're not part of the law of Moses anymore, you've got it. You know you're saved. You begin to walk into the law of Christ. You begin to wade into the river and you realize your life is not your own anymore, and you begin to do good. You begin to give and help people and so on, and the first time you get that smashed back in your face, you go down again. And I know there are people that understand the law of Moses, they understand they're free from it, the cross has dealt with that, but they've spent some time in the river. They've enjoyed the joy, but they have not enjoyed the pain that comes through serving. And they go down again. They go down again. And Jesus, whenever Jesus sees a person go down, he doesn't look for what's wrong. He doesn't look for what's right. He looks at the immediate need. And the immediate need is lift up your head. Lift up your head. It's okay. It happened to me. Lift up your head. It's okay. Expect these things. Don't stop doing good. Your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Christ is coming back with his reward. It's okay. Carry on doing good. You will be heartbroken, but carry on. In 1978, Bob Dylan became a Christian. I believe that man experienced God in a way that very few people did. When I listened to his first two or three albums, he's a Jew, I'd never heard anybody grasp the Bible like Bob Dylan. I once played his songs to a guy from Albania who was really into music. He says, I've never heard praise and worship like that ever in my life. I have never heard anybody so touch the throne of God as Bob Dylan. But Bob Dylan ended up getting brokenhearted in church. He saw things. He's just won an award for his poetry. I'll try and read you one of the verses of one of the songs that he did just as he was leaving the church. In the Psalms it says, let not the foot of pride come upon my life, right? So Bob Dylan wrote a song called The Foot of Pride. And this is one verse. Well, they'll choose a man for you to meet tonight. You'll play the fool and learn how to walk through doors. How to enter into the gates of paradise? No. How to carry a burden too heavy to be yours. From the stage, they're trying to get water out of rocks. They pass the hat around, collect $100,000 and say thanks. They like to take all this money from sin, build big universities to study in, and sing Amazing Grace all the way to the Swiss banks. And there ain't no coming back. When the foot of pride comes down, there ain't no coming back. Bob Dylan left the law of Moses, embraced the law of Christ, went into the river and got heartbroken and decided to go backwards. You can't go backwards. We sang this morning, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Have you been hurt? Of course you've been hurt. Have you been hurt doing good? Of course you've been hurt doing good. You know why? Satan hates it when you do good. Have you shared the gospel with somebody and been attacked? It's what happens. Are you greater than your master? No. You're in the team. You're in the club. And it's a privilege. That's what Jesus says. This is exactly what happened yesterday. I was just writing down this verse, Bob Dylan. I was just writing this down. Get a phone call. A guy who I've only ever met once. And he said, can you remember me? You were there praying with somebody that professes to have a terminal illness. And we prayed together. Do you remember me? I said, I do remember you, yeah. He said, well, I've got no one else to turn to. I don't know what to do. I'm at my wit's end. And I then knew what was coming, because we have discernment. He said, this person says that they're terminally ill. I said, yeah, I know what you're going to tell me. Well, they pleaded poverty with me. I said, yes. And I felt so compassionate for them because my wife died of cancer at the same time that his wife died of cancer. So this man, who was an ex-policeman, and I tell you what, it's hard to kid a policeman, this man gave him all the money that he had, £8,000, on condition that it would come back within a few weeks. He phoned me up to say, I'm at the end of my tether. I said, you won't see that money again. You've been had, and I know how much it hurts. And this is the problem, folks. This is the problem. Because when we begin to fulfill the law of Christ, and we love God, and we love our neighbor, there are people even in the church that will take advantage of that. You see, folks, we're to be as wise as a serpent and as harmless as a dove. What do you do? Here's a man, he says to me on the phone, I'm in the red. I've got no money. I did exactly what I thought was the right thing. I gave him all my money. I am now in the red. What do? You get back in the river. You get back in the river. It's hard. But the enemy goes around like a roaring lion. And every time it happens, we wisen up a bit, but we can't allow the devil to harden our hearts. Let me finish with one scripture. I didn't mean to go on this long this morning. But I'll finish with one last scripture and you'll understand it. And I hope I'm speaking to people this morning. Luke chapter 21. I'll start from verse 16. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relatives and friends. They will put some of you to death. That's what you signed up for when you decided to follow Jesus. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. For my name's sake. But not a hair of your head shall be lost. I'm claiming that, Lord. By your patience possess your souls. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, let those who are in the midst of her depart, and let those who are in the country enter her, not enter her. For these are the days of vengeance, that all things which are written might be fulfilled. But woe to those who are pregnant, to those who are nursing babes in those days, for there will be great distress in the land and wrath upon the people. They will fall by the edge of the sword, be led captive away into all the nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. There will be signs in the sun and in the moon, in the stars and on the earth, distress of nations, perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of the things which are coming upon the earth. For the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. Then you will see the Son of Man come in the cloud with power and great glory. Listen. When these things begin to happen, look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh. When these things begin to happen, when you've been betrayed by your brother, by your mother, by your sister, by your family, when you've tasted what it is to be rejected as a Christian, look up, straighten up, straighten your back up. It's okay. Happened to Jesus, it's going to happen to you. Look up. Lift up your head. Your redemption is drawing near. God bless you all. In Jesus' name.